guys have all seen this slogan. You've seen it on t-shirts and bags and other stuff from Jup Mode on Adams Street, where I'm standing today. But what you might not know is how this sign, which originally existed on top of the Valentine, was lit up and was enormous. You may not know how this sign relates to the beginning of World War I. On December 17th of 1913, it was a 150 square foot electric sign that hissed to life atop the Valentine building, and 7,000 light bulbs spelled out, "You will do better in Toledo." Mayor Brand Whitlock, who was in his last of four terms as the city's mayor, accepted the sign on behalf of the city, and it became our unofficial slogan. Days later, Mayor Whitlock wrapped up his affairs in Toledo and headed to Washington, D.C., where President Woodrow Wilson had tabbed him to be America's ambassador to Belgium. In the beginning of 1914, when Whitlock took that job in Belgium, it must have seemed like a really cushy assignment in a beautiful northern European capital city close to every cultural capital of the old world.
The Europe that Brand Whitlock arrived in might have seemed peaceful on the surface, but behind the scenes, there were things going into action that no one really could have anticipated. Now, I say that because all of you, like me, when I was a freshman in high school, took world history and were taught that there were the four main causes of the First World War: militarism, alliances, imperialism, and nationalism. And then we were told the assassination of Archduke Franz Ferdinand in Sarajevo, this Austro-Hungarian monarch, that he's assassinated, and that sets into action all of these dominoes of militarism, alliances, imperialism, and nationalism. Now, my world history teacher was a great guy. Your world history teachers were great men and women, and they told you exactly what we've been taught in the past. One of the funny things about history, though, lots of people say, history never changes, must be nice to teach your subject. Actually, history does change. Our interpretations of the past change as we learn new things, and as we read new articles and books by people who study these things and try to draw different conclusions. And one of the most preeminent historians of the First World War at this time is Dr. Michael Nyberg. And Dr. Nyberg has written several books on the First World War, and I was part of a presentation that he gave a couple years ago. And it blew my mind, because Dr. Nyberg said, all of that stuff about MAIN is probably wrong. And I'm like, I've been teaching that to children for 15 years. So let's talk about Nyberg's thesis and how it relates to our understanding of how World War I began. So Dr. Nyberg says, none of these causes were actually getting worse at the time. None of them were developing at the time. And we can come up with pretty great counterexamples of how these don't lead to war in other circumstances many times. So first of all, most Europeans at this time believed militarism was declining. Alliances have existed over time and often don't cause war. The United States is in a number of alliances right now, none of which have directly led us into war in quite some time. Most imperial issues, by the time we get to 1914, many imperial issues had been resolved, and they had been resolved peacefully through diplomacy. And there was no reason for people to believe that wouldn't continue to happen. And finally, nationalism is not the primary driver of this war. Now, is nationalism going to play a big role as war breaks out and war develops? Yes, it will. But is it a cause and a driver that puts people into war? Nyberg argues no. So what was it? Well, let's take a second before we get to that. Dr. Nyberg argues that we all, in the United States at least, we tend to mock Europe for succumbing to irrational fears. We look at what happened there and we go, ah, what a bunch of idiots. How did they let that get out of control? And we're able to kind of look at the First World War as being less bad than it really was, because we think, well, we're smarter than those people, we'll never let something like that happen. When in fact, Nyberg's interpretation of the events leading up to World War I would lead most rational observers to say, absolutely, we could get caught up in something like that. So again, what was it? Well, let's talk about what it wasn't. Franz Ferdinand's death at the time, as people understood it then, was not a big deal. It was on the front pages for a day or two and then disappeared. And this is in June of 1914. Most people did not perceive the Archduke's death as a really big deal. But then weeks go by, and the Archduke was from Austria-Hungary. He had been assassinated by a Serbian. And there's kind of some back and forth between Austria-Hungary and Serbia about this action by this radical Serbian militant group. And again, people didn't pay that much attention because they believed diplomacy has solved a lot of problems. There's no reason to believe it won't solve this problem too. Diplomacy will come through in the end. And then you get the July crises. Over time, multiple things had happened and started drawing Austria closer to making kind of, we'll call them ambitious demands of Serbia instead of unreasonable, because unreasonable is maybe too much of a value judgment for me to make here. But on July 23rd, Austria delivers this ultimatum to the Serbians saying, you need to do X, Y, and Z, or there will be a state of war between us. Incredibly, 3 days later, Serbia actually gives in to almost all of these demands. And you would think, well, that solved it, except it didn't. The Austrians had already kind of issued pre-mobilization orders. They decided the fact that Serbia had not given in to 100% of their demands was good enough. And Austria declares war on Serbia. At that point, other things start happening. Germany had promised that no matter what Austria-Hungary does, we're going to stand by them. Serbia had made entreaties to Russia saying, please help us. And the Russians, seeing this is the right thing to do, seeing it as a chance that if we say we're going to stand up, it'll make war less likely. The Russians did back Serbia. And so then, now that Austria has declared war on Serbia, it appears Germany's going to get involved in this thing, and Russia mobilizes their military. And when the Russian mobilization begins and the German mobilization begins, that's when war starts to become, if not inevitable, incredibly likely. So, why is it happening? There's a really great book. If you're really into World War I, you obviously have to read The Guns of August. It's one of the best books about the war. Barbara Tuchman was not a historian, but she's one of the most gifted historical writers of the 20th century, and goes in detail into how the Germans kind of made this a war of timetables, that they believed we have to mobilize our military under these plans that we've had forever, even though they involved mobilizing the military towards France and not Russia initially. We need to do this right now to make everything work. Germany, at the outset of this, believes they can get a quick victory at a good time. They look to the future and they believe that their enemies, especially Russia, are going to be stronger in a couple years than they are right now. So if we're going to have a war, let's have it now when we're stronger than they are. As this is happening, Russia kind of believes, well, if Germany is moving a force towards our border, we have no choice but to mobilize our army, right? That's just good defense. France, once Germany lines up against the Russians, France believes we have no choice but to fulfill our treaty obligations to Russia, especially now that German soldiers are moving towards our border. Every nation involved in this believes at some level they're fighting a war of defense. None of them see themselves as the aggressors. Even the Germans, who kind of are the aggressors, the German people don't see themselves as the aggressors, frankly, because they don't necessarily know what their leadership is doing at the time. What happens next? Germany's army mobilizes to the east. They're in contact with Russia. The war with Russia is about to begin. And then the army in the west is showing up at the border between Germany and Belgium. And the German army is demanding, we must be let through Belgium. Belgium is a neutral country, which means they ain't beefing with anybody here. And they said, no, we're not going to let you pass through. That's a violation of our neutrality. And Britain had made a promise, if anybody violates Belgium's neutrality, we're going to hop in this war. The Germans kind of call the bluff, and Germany invades Belgium. When Belgium refuses and Germany invades, who's there to see it?
Brand Whitlock, the Toledo mayor who had dedicated this sign just a few years earlier, was in Belgium when the shooting started in World War I. He wrote in his journal that his French-speaking Belgian aide, Omer, woke him up with a loud knock on the door, saying, "C'est la guerre, Excellence," or "It is war, sir." Germany's violation of Belgium's neutrality was another major domino to fall and drew France and Britain into the war.
So, the course of war after that, after Germany rolls into Belgium, after the British Expeditionary Force comes over, after the British and French fight, let's be clear, side by side, not together, against the Germans for a while. You can learn about the course of the war in your world history class. That's not the province of an American history class. But as you all know, within a few months, the defensive lines in the West bog down, and this becomes the trench warfare that you famously learned about when you were freshmen. On the Eastern Front, a war that we don't talk about as much in our world history classes, in the Eastern Front, it's not a trench warfare war. It's a war that goes back and forth. Each side plans massive offensive every few months, and they launch a big attack, and you know it succeeds to some degree or it fails to some degree, and nothing is really decisive. Nothing ends that war in the East. It's just these massive attacks back and forth and back and forth. 1917 is really the decisive year in the war. From 1914 to 1917, you have this static war in the West, this very back and forth war in the East. But in 1917, that war in the East is going to change with the change in the Allies, and things are about to change with the entry of another country in the West.
By the spring of 1917, the war had been raging in Europe for 3 years, and in April, a series of events would draw America, so reluctant to fight, into the battle.